יוסף מזרחי. That is a very big pleasure and a very big scoop that we have here today in São Paulo and in the whole Brazil to hear your very, very good lecture. Just a little few words in Portuguese. Para quem não conhece, Rabbi Yosef Mizrachi, ele é um dos rabanim, hoje em dia, mais famosos do mundo inteiro, que dá palestras, seminários com mais de um milhão de CDs, que ele já falou pelo mundo inteiro em várias línguas, muitas línguas, e ele está hoje se disponibilizando assim para a gente, assim que a gente pediu para ele vir falar hoje para o Macom e para São Paulo, ele se dispôs. É um grande mérito estar podendo escutar ele.
Good evening, thank you, Kvod Arav, thank you. Good evening, everyone in São Paulo, Brazil. Baruch Hashem, I'm honored to speak to you here tonight. I know you're 1 hour ahead of us, so by the time I finish the lecture, it's the time you started the lecture. And so, Baruch Hashem, I was told maybe I should speak about some things about strengthening the emunah, the faith in the Torah. And for those of you who knows me, I don't convince people to believe in the Torah. I prove to them 100% that the Torah is from God, it's divine. Once I do that, it's a lot easier for them to follow. If they know it's 100%, it's much easier to follow. If they will always have a doubt, it will be a lot harder to follow. This is the way it works. So I made a very famous film that it's called Torah and Science. It's a 4-hour Jewish seminar. It gives one proof after the other. The entire four hours, one scientific proof after the other that our Torah can never be written by a human being, no matter how smart he is. Even if you take thousands of them, they cannot write such a book. Why? Because in the Torah, first of all, you have knowledge about nature that no human being has even until today. Nobody has this kind of knowledge, which I'm going to give maybe a few examples soon. And also, the Torah is full of prophecies. The Torah took huge risk by giving prophecies to the future, even though these prophecies were against all odds. The chance that these prophecies would happen was 1 to 1 billion. But the Torah still gave those prophecies, and they all happened one after the other throughout the generations. And obviously we know that there's no person that knows even what's going to be tomorrow, not to talk about next year, not to talk about in 1,000 years, right? So no human being can give prophecies. And we see that the Torah is full of them. On top of all of that, you have hidden mathematical codes inside the Torah, which are amazing. Not only mathematically it's amazing, scientifically it's amazing, statistically it's amazing, it's also amazing when it predicts the future. So it's not only that inside such a thick book you have a lot of different hidden names in equal mathematical scheme in the text, that's different mathematical codes. They also speak about events that will happen in the future. So there are a few ways to prove that the Torah is divine. Few ways. One way is by proving that the Torah knew the future. Second way is that the Torah has hidden mathematical skips inside that also speaks about the future. Names, events, war, prime ministers, all kinds of famous events that happen in history. Another way to prove that the Torah is from God is because if you analyze the Torah, and if you try to assume that the person that gave us the Torah is the one who made it up, in a case like this, you will have to ask yourself hundreds of questions. Question number one, when a person wants to give a book, a fake book, not a book that he got from God. He claims that he got it from God, but he never got it from God. So he comes to a group of people and he gives them the book that he wrote. Now, when a person like this writes a book, does he write an easy book to keep or a difficult book to keep? Every fool understands that the more difficult you make the book, the harder it is to convince the people to follow it. If you come to the people and you say, there are five things to do, that's it. Once a year you give one time charity, once a year you pray 10 minutes, one day a year you cannot eat for 2 hours, and you do kiddush on Shabbat, you take a glass of wine, you drink, and then you can do whatever you want, as long as you mention the word Shabbat once a week. That's it, just about it. You can do everything else you want. Of course, everyone would like it. What's the problem? It's nothing to do. It's very easy. No one will fight you. And it will be a lot more convincing when you come to the people and you tell them, join me, God gave me this book. Why should I fight you? Big deal, there's nothing to do. That's what we have to do, no big deal. However, when you come to the people and you tell them there are 613 commandments, right away they get very scared. 613. Why would you choose such a number, 613? Why not 500, 600, 700, 200, an even number? Why 613? Second, if you analyze all the 613 commandments, you will find that 80% of them are against human logic. Not only you cannot understand that in human logic, it's the exact opposite of human logic. What person would make 400 mitzvot to sacrifice animal in the altar in a Bet HaMikdash, to build a beautiful building, make an altar, bring the animal, slaughter them, do all kinds of strange things, take the blood, put it on the ear, put it on the toe, and splash some of the blood over here, and splash some of the blood over there, and these parts of the animal you give to the Kohen. Why did he even make such a thing, Kohen? And some of it the person has to eat, and some of it you have to burn, and you have a limited time to eat it. A lot of very strange things that no human being will make such rules. Why would they make such rules when nobody first understands them? Second, it costs a lot of money to slaughter all the animal. Every goat, every sheep, in our days, is about $300. So if you buy a $300 sheep, multiply by 1 million every month, you know, 3.5 million people, it's enough. Every once in a while they make a sin, not intentional sin. They have to bring a goat to the Bet HaMikdash, to wait online, to give it to the Kohen. The Kohen slaughter it. It's called Korban Chatat. It's millions of dollars going to the waste. You burn it, a lot of it goes to the garbage. And it takes away the life of the people, because some people in the old days, they had to come all the way to Yerushalayim from the north of Israel, from the south of Israel. They have to take a donkey, come all the way to Jerusalem. They didn't have cars, they didn't have such roads, so they have to ride on a donkey until they arrive to Jerusalem, or on a horse. By the time they get there, they wait all day online to bring their goat. They have to go to the market to buy a sheep, to go and stand online, to give it to the Kohen. The Kohen slaughter it. They say, be careful, don't make the sin again. What was the sin? I did by mistake a little laundry on Shabbat. There was a little stain on my clothes, so I took water and I cleaned it. That's the sin, by mistake. And someone said, oh, you're not allowed this Shabbat. You're not allowed to do laundry on Shabbat. Oh, yeah, I forgot. Okay, now I have to go all the way to Yerushalayim. A lot of very strange things. That first of all, no human being would dream to make such rules. What does he gain by that? If I want to make a fake book, what is the motive for a person to come and bring a book to a group of people? First, he wants to be famous. Second, he wants to control all the people. Third, he thinks he's the smartest one, so he should make the rules. Fourth, he wants to be remembered after he died as a person that was the king, the leader. Five, he wants money. He wants people to give him money. Six, he wants people to honor him, that everybody will give him respect because he's the king, the messenger of God. I think more or less I actually covered everything. So let's go one by one. When Moshe Rabbeinu brought the Torah to the Jewish nation, what did he write about himself? That he's stuttering, that Hashem punished him, he did not enter Israel, that his children were not worthy enough to take his place. His student Yoshua ben Nun took his place, but his children were not good enough to take his place. And there's a lot of problems about Moshe in the Torah. Why would he write all these bad things about himself? When a person writes a biography today, make sure not to put anything bad in a book, only the good things about himself. No one will write that he's mentally sick, that he's a thief, that he murdered people, that he has a defect in his body. Nobody will write such thing. You only write the good things about yourself. Why would they say in the Torah that he got punished, that God got angry at him, that he was stuttering? There's all kinds of other problems. That's question number one. So honor he didn't get. Also in the Torah it described that many times the nation fought him. He had big fights with them. If you wrote the book, why do you have to write that people came to fight against you and the nation got angry at you because Korach and 250 people died, so everybody came and said it's your fault? Why would you write such a thing about yourself? Why everybody in the world has to know that because of you 251 people died? There's a lot of questions that we have to ask. Second thing is, the more difficult the commandments are and the more in number, the more the people will hate you, especially when some of these commandments are very expensive. People have to give a lot of money for it, to buy tefillin, to buy mezuzot, to do brit milah, to get a meal. You know, a lot of mitzvot is very, very expensive, to buy a sukkah, to build a sukkah, to buy arbat aminim to you and all your children. It could be thousands of dollars. So the question is, why? What did he gain by that? Why Moshe care if you hold a lulav like this, or if you sit in a sukkah, or if you slaughter an animal, or if you eat once a year a matzah? Does he care what you eat? What does it give him? Does he give him money? No. He gives him respect? No. It makes the people to love him? No, they hate him more. One other mitzvah, if you marry to your aunt, until now it was allowed, from now on it's not allowed. You cannot be married to your aunt, the sister of your father. Until now, there was no Torah. You marry your aunt, you had 10 children. Come, Mr. Moshe, comes from with the Torah, Rabotai, God gave me this book. Those of you who married to their aunt, it's a big problem. You cannot be married to your aunt. Ervat dodatcha lo tegale, it's written. Some of them have a big issue now. What are they going to do now? Or they plan to get married to their aunt, or they're already married to their aunt. Who is married to their aunt? Moshe Rabbeinu's parents. His father Amram, married to Yocheved, was his aunt. So Moshe goes against his parents. He's speaking against his own parents. What's going on over here? Then Moshe writes about his brother Aaron, that he also died. He did not enter Israel. And that his sister Miriam spoke Lashon Hara about him. Why do you have to write about her? Why are you speaking against your own sister? You put in the book that she was punished for 1 week. She had leprosy. It's very strange. What person would do such thing? Right? Then there's another mitzvah. If you see a bird in a nest, you get rid of the mother and you take the chicks and you put them somewhere. And thanks, when the mother comes back to the nest, the mother finds out that the babies are gone. Thanks to that, you're going to have long life. But who would make such a... What human being will make such a law? First of all, it's very strange. What's the connection between long life to being cruel to the bird? What's the connection? Second, what did you get by that? What, you, Mr. Moshe, what did you gain by telling me to do such thing? Did you get money? No. Did you make me like you? No. Did you make the people accept the Torah easier? No. So what's the point of it? So we see, the more we check, we find out that no human being would write such a book, because all these mitzvot are way above our understanding. We don't understand the logic behind it. For instance, red cow. You have a mitzvah, it's called red cow. You take the red cow, you slaughter it, you burn it, you take the ashes, you mix it with some other spices and water, spring water from Jerusalem. You take it, you splash on the impure people, they become pure. If somebody pure touch it, it become impure. The same water. It can make a person pure, it can make a pure person impure. Besides, you know, who invented this idea to be pure, to be not pure? There's nothing to do with body clean or not clean. The body can be very dirty, but you're pure. You went into the mikveh. You went into the ocean. You dipped in the ocean. You immersed in the ocean. You're good. You're pure. Even though your body has a lot of dirt on it. But on the other hand, you can take 10 showers in a row. You clean yourself with soap, shampoo, everything. You clean your body perfectly, but you did not go into the mikveh. You're not pure. What human being would care about pure, not pure? If a woman has a period, After the period finished, she stay impure for the rest of her life, unless she go into the mikveh. The only thing that can remove the impurity, if she's going to go into the mikveh, and if she doesn't go into the mikveh, she will stay like this for the rest of her life. Who cares about pure, not pure? She's clean now, no blood, nothing is disgusting. Let her husband be with her. What do you care now? So we see, Rabotai, psychologically, no human being will make such laws. It's against his own will. It's like you coming to do something and you fight yourself that he won't be successful. And we see that Moshe Rabbeinu gave them the Torah, and inside the Torah there is a verse, all of you heard me speaking to God. You heard his voice coming down to you. It says clearly, all of you saw me and heard me speaking to God. If something like this did not happen, few of them would raise their hand and say, excuse me, Mr. Moshe, you're a very nice guy, but I don't understand what you're talking about. You're hallucinating. None of us heard God. None of us heard you speaking to him. We don't know what you're talking about. We've been standing here in Mount Sinai. Anybody here heard the voice of God? They all would say, no, we didn't hear God. He's making up stories. And it's written in the Torah, Moshe yedaber, ve'elokim ya'anenu bekol. Moshe is speaking, and God answering him with voice. Why do you have to write, Moshe speaks, and God answer him with voice? Why do you need the word with voice? If God answer him, we understand. Moshe speaks, and God answer him. Why? That people won't come later on and say, oh, you know what happened over there? Moshe spoke and God answered him, but we didn't hear God. Nobody heard God. Moshe pretend that he listens to him. Wait a minute, be quiet. Let me hear what God say in my ear. He's whispering something in my ear. Oh, God told me to tell you such and such. Again, be quiet, let me hear. Everybody can put a show like this. I'm talking to God now, you're disturbing me. Let me hear. So everybody will go like this. Oh, he's listening to God. We have to be quiet. Okay, what did God tell you to tell us? But then it would not be approved. But when everybody heard the voice of God, as the Torah say, if one of them did not hear the voice of God, he would raise his hand, and right away you will have one mistake in the Torah, because the Torah say, all of you, with no exception to the rule, all of you heard me speaking to God. If it did not happen, first of all, he would not make himself look like a fool. If I want to fool a bunch of 3.5 million people, and I come and give them a book that I know I myself made it up, God never gave it to me, and I come to them, will I tell them it's written in a book that all of you heard me speaking to God, knowing something like this never happened? I would look like the dumbest person in history. Hey, what are you talking about? We never heard God. What voice are you talking about? What shofar, what fire, what the floor is shaking, the ground is shaking, there's a voice of siren, voice of shofar, fire all over the Mount Sinai, the voice of God coming out. All of them got so scared after the second commandment, they died. They just could not stay alive from fear. And Moshe had to relax them and tell them, don't worry, God did not come to hurt you. He's only here to test you. He's giving you the Torah. So we have, Rabotai, hundreds of different proofs to prove that this Torah could never ever be written by human beings. Let's talk a little bit about science. Scientific. The Torah said to the Jews, you want to eat seafood? No problem. These are the rules. Everything you catch in the ocean, in the rivers, any water in the world, 72% of the world is water, by the way. The depth that they reach is 12 kilometers, like 8 miles. It's very deep. 8 miles is very deep. 12 kilometers is 120 soccer fields. In Brazil, I know they love football very much. So you know, everybody knows what a soccer field is. It's 100 meters. 12 kilometers is 120 soccer fields, meaning it's very, very deep. and there's a lot of pressure. They send the rope all the way down with a special weight, all the way, and they measure the rope. It went all the way 12 kilometers. 72% of the world is water. 72%, almost three quarter of the world is all blue, if you look at the globe. And the Torah was written 3,330 years ago. Let's say 3,300 years ago. And in the Torah, it said to the Jews, would you like to eat something from the water? Make sure that it has two witnesses that it's kosher. Who are the two witnesses? Everything that you catch in the water must have fins and must have scales. Scales is those things on the skin that when you scratch it, they fall off. And fins, this is how they swim, with the fins. So, beautiful. Everything that doesn't have fins and scales, it's not kosher. If it has those two signs, it's kosher. You don't need to know what's the name of the fish. You never saw it in your life. It could be not something that it's not fish. It doesn't have to be a fish. Anything that has scales and fins, it's kosher. Now, we have to understand one very important thing. In the written Torah, it says these are the Torahs. Not Torah, not single, plural. These are the Torahs and the boards of stone that I put in the hand of Moshe in Mount Sinai. Torahs, plural. What does it mean, Torahs? Written Torah and oral Torah. And the Ten Commandments on a board. But written and oral. What does it mean, oral Torah? Why do you need oral Torah? We call it Torah Shebe'al Pei Nibu. Why you need oral Torah? Why not everything written in one book and that's it? The answer is, if you have to write the Torah plus all the laws in one scroll, the size of that scroll will be at least 100 times bigger than what we have right now. And if you know, when you pick up the Torah now, you need a very strong guy. There are people who do not have enough strength to pick it up. Imagine if you have 100 Torahs combined and you have to pick it up. No one in the world will be able to move it. You would need 30, 40 people to move it an inch. So it's not realistic. You cannot write in one book so much knowledge. So that's one question. Then you may ask, okay, so why didn't you divide it to many different books? One scroll for the five books of Moses. One scroll for Masechet Shabbat. One scroll for Masechet Brachot. One scroll for Masechet Kiddushin and Gittin. You could have made many different scrolls. The answer is that God wanted the oral Torah to be oral, not written. It's against the law. It was against the law to write it down. Why? Because once the Jews got the Torah in Mount Sinai, the whole world was in shock. The whole world, all the nations, heard that God gave the Jewish people 7 weeks after they came out of Egypt, He gave them the Torah in a public event. How do we know it? You read later on in the book of Joshua that sent the spies to Israel before the Jews came to Israel. He sent spies. They came to the house of Rahav. She had a prostitution home. They came over there, she hid them over there, and she told them, all of us are shaking from fear. We know you on the way here. We heard of what your God did to the Egyptians, and I will help you and save your life and hide you from the police. But when you come here, make sure you keep me alive. So they told her, no problem, put all your family with you in the house, tie a sheet from the window, and the soldiers will know they don't touch your house. Later she converted and she married Yoshua ben Nun. There was a very interesting end to that story. Later on she was a very pretty woman. She converted, she became very righteous. From here we learned the power of Baalei Tshuva. If a person was very wicked, he was rebelling against God all his life, but then he made Tshuva, he made repentance. He stopped with his sins, he became a tzaddik, became righteous. Everything he did in his past is all erased. That's why someone like Rahav was able to marry the most important righteous person in the world, Yoshua ben Nun, that took the place of Moshe Rabbeinu. Otherwise, who would make such a shidduch? The answer is, nobody cares what you used to be. You became righteous. You did tshuva. Yom Kippur passed. You don't repeat the sins. You pray. You ask God to forgive you. You give charity. You became a much better person. That's the end of it. You don't remind the Baal tshuva is passed. This is the rule. So what happened? So everybody knew that the Jews got the Torah. Immediately, in one generation, they translated the Torah to 70 different languages. If the Goyim has the Torah, the Gentiles, what prevent them from keeping it? Right away, they make themselves more Torah, they make themselves tefillin, they write themselves mezuzot, they know how to do brit milah. If everything would be written in the Torah, all the laws, all the oral laws, everything would be in one book, or in few books, the Goyim would copy it. You would not know after two generations who is a Jew and who is not a Jew. Everyone had beards in the old day. Everyone was wearing turbans. If the Goyim would come and say, we are Jewish from a different country, you would not know. They know how to put tefillin. They know how to do brit milah. They learn Torah. They have their own Torah. How would you know who's a Jew and who's not a Jew? There would not be a way to know. So after two generations, all the people in the world, nobody would know who is Jewish and who is not Jewish. Because the Goyim wanted to join the nation of God, everybody. Just like we see when the Jews came out of Egypt, a lot of Egyptians told Moshe Rabbeinu, take us with you. We don't want to stay here, we want to join the Jewish nation after what we saw happen in Egypt. So it would be defeating the entire Torah. So God say you're not allowed to write the oral laws. But you have to understand one thing. You have 613 commandments written in the Torah, and there's not one explanation in the written Torah how to keep it. Not even one. All you have is very interesting, is the name of the mitzvah. That's it. And sometimes you don't even understand what he talks about. For instance, it says, "V'haya le'ot al yadecha ul'totafot ben enecha." It doesn't say what. You have to have a sign on your hand and in between your eyes. That's what it says about tefillin. It doesn't say it has to be black, it has to be square. From what animal you take the skin, how do you make shin in one side of three and the other side shin with four? What do you write inside? How you divide it inside? What happens if there's holes inside? None of these things. There's more than 1,000 halachot. How to make tefillin. If one of them you did not do correctly, the tefillin is not kosher. Where did they get these 1,000 laws from? It's not written in the Torah. As a matter of fact, the Torah doesn't even have the word tefillin. In the Torah, it doesn't say it's supposed to be black, but everybody knows you never found any tefillin in the history that it's not black. No matter where the Jews live, they always had the same tefillin. Same square tefillin, you never had round tefillin. There's always the same tefillin no matter where you go. And they tie it on the hand with the same stripe. So what's going on over here? The answer is very simple. You have the mitzvah written in a written Torah. Then Hashem gave Moshe Rabbeinu all the laws that apply to this mitzvah verbally. Don't write it down, that it does not fall to the hands of the nations. If the nation will know all the secrets of all the mitzvot, and then they'll keep everything. And then you will never be able to know anymore. They teach their children, grandchildren, and everyone will pretend they're Jewish. You will have hundreds of millions of goyim. I have thousands of goyim every month, writing to me so many emails. Just you go on my YouTube pages, and you see in every lecture there's so many comments by Gentiles that love Hashem, love Judaism, love the Torah. Some of them keep Shabbat. Some of them order tefillin. Some of them buy mezuzot. Some of them circumcise their children. And they're not even Jewish yet. They just keep the seven laws of Noah. But in the old days, if all the Gentiles will have all the laws of the Torah, they would come and pretend they are Jewish. And there's nothing you'll be able to do about it. They wouldn't need to wait 2 years to convert, to go through a test. They would just come and say, we know everything, test us. We already know, we have the Torah, everything is written. So that will be the end of Judaism before it even started. So let's go back to what we say. So now, everybody sees in the Torah 613 commandments. Why 613? Why not 500? Why not 400? Why not 700? Why such a number? Because the human body is built with 613 parts, 248 organs, 365 ligaments. And for every organ in the Torah, you have one positive commandment, mitzvat aseh. And for every negative mitzvah, restriction in the Torah, which is 365 restrictions, you have you have 365 ligaments in the body, and you have 365 ligaments in 365 restrictions in the Torah. So together, for every organ, you have a positive mitzvah, 248 altogether. For every ligament, you have a restriction in the Torah, which is 365 restrictions. So it's very interesting. For every ligament, restriction. For every organ, mitzvah, positive mitzvah. This is how the body is built. And it's unbelievable because it's like one puzzle with 613 parts. Now comes Moshe, he gives them the Torah, and the Torah describes everything that happened to them in Egypt. All the miracles, blood, frogs, every firstborn in Egypt died, 1 week of darkness, you know, bad animals came, hail falling from heaven, all kinds of things that happened to them. If it did not happen, how would Moshe be able to give them a Torah and say, all of that happened to you in Egypt? You were slaves and God released you, and he gave the Egyptian all this punishment, and he opened the Red Sea for you, and you went through, and the Egyptian that chased you, they all drowned, and God is giving you bread from heaven every day, as you can all see. Who can tell such fairy tales to people unless it's really happening? What are you trying to prove? What do you think? We're all blind? We don't see? Where is the man? Where is the manna? There's nothing falls. We don't see any bread. We don't see a whale coming with us. We don't see all these things. We don't see a pillar of fire, GPS, made in heaven. GPS, first GPS, is the pillar of fire that Hashem actually put and shows them the way. Follow the pillar of fire. So, Rabotai, to come to a group of people and tell them stories and miracles that happened to them. All it needs is one of these miracles that did not happen, and right away they will tell him, you're a liar. This book is not from God. Why it's not from God? Because if you have one human error in a book that claimed to be the book of God, how can you rely on this book? God doesn't make mistakes. If he created such a world, like it's written over here in Genesis, he created such a world in less than a second. Somebody like that doesn't make mistakes. Somebody like that does not make human errors. How many religions and cults came after the Torah? The answer, more than 80,000 religions and cults. More than 80,000, Rabotai. Do you know what we're talking here about? 80,000, a huge number. We know Christianity, Islam, Buddhism, Hinduism, Krishna. How many religions we know? I don't think 99% of the people in the world cannot even name five religions. Most people don't know. But if you see the list, there is more than 80,000. Most of them are small cults, but there are many, many religions. Now the question is, what is the main difference between Judaism to all the fake religions and cults that came later on? The answer is, every religion started with the story of one person. One person. One person came and he said that God came to him, or the angel gave him a book. This is how it started. Islam. Muhammad came, saying the angel Gabriel gave him the Quran. How many people saw it? Nobody. He said that he was alone. Mary, Christianity. Mary, she got engaged to Joseph the carpenter. He goes away. He comes back after a few months. What happened? How come you're pregnant? I never touched you. No, don't worry. God came to me in a dream. He made me pregnant. You know, I'm still a virgin. And what? How many people witnessed that dream? Of course, nobody. Nobody knows what's a dream of someone else's. Story of one woman that had a reason to lie to save her life. Because in the old days, if a woman cheated on her man after they got engaged, engagement in the old days was chupa and kiddushin. They actually had a chupa, he put the ring on her finger, and he went away. Then he comes back with some money. That's the way it used to be. He comes with money. They have to move in to build the house. When he comes, he sees she was with another man. She denies it. She says, God made me pregnant. Question number one, Christians do not deny that the Torah is divine. They say, God gave the Jews the Torah in Mount Sinai. We are the witnesses for it. We're not denying it. We just claim that God gave part two. And in part two, what they call the New Testament, why would God go to a married woman that already had chupa and kiddushim with another man and made her pregnant that the boy would be mamzer? The Torah, our Torah, say that nobody is allowed to touch the married woman. It's a very, very big sin with the death penalty for her and for the cheater, for both. So if both of them did such thing, both of them should be executed. Definitely God would not come to a married woman and make her pregnant when she's married to someone else. There's a lot of single women. If you wanted to bring somebody important to the world, go to a single woman. Why would you go to a married one? That's a very, very hard question. Second, how are we supposed to believe a story of a woman that have all the reason to lie when, if not, they're going to give her a death penalty because she's a married woman who cheated? So she has to make up a story. Based on that, you want to start a religion? On a dream that she claimed she had? Or Muhammad that claimed that he was in the desert and God made him the prophet and he sent him Angel Gabriel to give him the Quran? When Muhammad himself did not know how to read and did not know how to write. So why would God come to a non-Jew who does not know a word of Torah, is not a righteous person, is a big murderer, as the Quran testified, he killed all the other people that did not want to follow him, and on top of everything, you know, never gave one prophecy in his entire Quran. You don't have one prophecy. They call him Prophet Muhammad, but there's not one prophecy over there, not even one. Same thing the New Testament, not one prophecy inside. On the other hand, it has tons of mistakes, human errors, one after the other. In every page, mistakes and mistakes and mistakes. I don't have time to get into it, but if you watch my film, Torah and Science, Part 1, it's divided to three parts. Over there, I show a few mistakes from the Quran and few mistakes from the New Testament that proves in 10 minutes that the Quran and the New Testament are definitely not the book of God. Therefore, Christianity and Islam are both fake religion 100%. And everybody who wastes his time on it not only get nothing, they will also be punished for it. Because some of these fake religions, they teach the Gentiles all kinds of things that is against the rules of God. So not only doesn't help them, it actually makes it worse for them. They put the effort, and they get in the end the punishment. Now let's talk about Jews, because that's why we gather here today. I was told a few times that in Brazil, there are a lot of secular people, Jews, that are considering themselves traditional. What does it mean traditional? To be honest, they keep nothing. Nothing. Maybe they have mezuzah in their home, and that's just about it. I also heard from a friend of mine that lives in Sao Paulo that many, many thousands of Jews married non-Jews. Women marry non-Jewish men and men marry not Jewish women. So I heard that the spiritual situation in Brazil is worse than horrible. That's the truth. That's what I heard from someone that lives there all his life. You know, so he told me, the situation over here is extremely terrible. Spirituality here is horrible. Why? The Brazilian Jews, they're very nice people. You know, they're all very polite, they have class. In their mind, they think that the religion is a hobby. It's for the rabbis. The rabbi is supposed to be religious. The rabbis will tell us a little bit about the religion. It's like a folklore. You know, it's very nice. Once a year we come to the synagogue, maybe Yom Kippur, we hear the nice speech, or maybe in a wedding, or in a Brit Milah, or in a bar mitzvah of one of the boys, the boy will say 5 minutes something from the parasha, and as long as you are a good person, everything is fine. The answer is nothing is fine. Nothing is fine. It's horrible. Why it's horrible? Because the Torah, first of all, it's not only for the rabbis. It's for all the Jewish people in the whole world, in all the generations until the end of days. The Torah will never ever change. The Torah have 13 principles. These are the 13 principles of Judaism. Just like you have the 10 commandments, you have the 13 principles of Judaism. If you contradict or deny one of the 13 principles, you cannot never ever be a kosher Jew. As a matter of fact, when the Gentiles come to the Jewish bedding to convert to Judaism, first thing they must know for sure by heart and declare that they believe 100% in the 13 principles. If they say one of them I don't believe, you're not allowed to convert them. Why? How can you convert them? They can never be kosher Jews. The problem is that almost all the Jewish people in the world do not even know the 13 principles of Judaism. This is a very sad joke, that Jews don't even know the basic about their own religion. They never learn it. Sometimes it's not their fault. Their parents never send them to yeshiva. They went to public school and they learned secular studies of goyim. Never learned yeshiva. So how would they know? Most Jews in the world do not know the Ten Commandments. Most Jews in the world cannot even tell you the right orders of the Jewish holidays. They maybe know the holidays, but they don't know the right order of the holidays. Most Jews in the world do not really know why we're celebrating the holidays. For instance, if you go to Israel, Israel, the land of the Jews, the land of the Israelis who are born in a Hebrew land, you ask 90% of the secular Israeli, at least 90%, maybe 99%, but 90 for sure, you ask them, what are the significance of each holiday? They have no idea what you want from them. You ask them, what's Rosh Hashanah? They say, the beginning of a new year. Okay, and what else? They have no idea. They don't know that it's the judgment day, the annual judgment day for the entire past year. That now is the judgment, what you did right and what you did wrong. Everybody gets his score. They have no idea. They never heard once in their life that today is a judgment day. Not only they don't care about the judgment because they never heard about the judgment, they go to Tiberias without a shirt, playing racquetball, swimming, doing shish kebab, playing sheshbesh. They are being judged and they don't even have any idea that today is the annual judgment day for the whole world. People, Jews, non-Jews, animals, every country, every state is all being judged. What you see now happening in the whole world in the last 2 months with this coronavirus, every city, every street, every person, everyone was judged in the last Rosh Hashanah. Who's going to live, who's going to die, who will be sick and get healed, who will be sick and die, who will suffer 1 month, who will suffer 1 day. Some people got corona 1 day. The next day, it stopped. It's gone. No fever, no cough, no nothing. A little bit they couldn't taste, and it was over after a day and a half. Some people, 1 month in hospital, respirator, all these things that they gave them, almost died. And in the end, they made it. Some people died after a week. Some people died after a month. All kinds of things that happened this year, all the tragedies, include Brazil, that got it very bad as well. And the only place in the world that did not get it as bad as the other is mamash, the best out of all the countries in the world was surprisingly Israel. Very crowded communities. Only 270 people died in Israel, which almost all of them were very, very old and sick. Maybe 15 people were young that died. We don't know why God decided that some young people will also die, but most of the people would die anyway within weeks or months. It's people that were in 88, 96, 94. People like this eventually die. They don't stay forever. But all these decisions were all made in the last Rosh Hashanah, and most of the Jewish people in the world have no idea what the judgment day is. Also Yom Kippur. You tell most of the Jewish people in the world what Yom Kippur is. They know it's a day, a special day. They know it's an important day, but they don't really know the details. They don't know what does it mean to do tshuva. They don't know the prayers. They don't know the significance of Yom Kippur. They have no idea. They don't know what mitzvot ben adam lamakom, mitzvot ben adam lechavero, that it's two separate sins. Some sins is between men to God, and some sins is between men to men or men to society. They have no idea. The ignorance among the people in the world is the most dangerous thing to the life of a human being. Because when 99.9% of the people in the world do not even know what the purpose of life is, how do you expect them ever to fulfill their mission in life? If you don't know what's your mission, let's say the government wants to send you on a mission in another country, to be an ambassador, to be a spy, to be a doctor, whatever the case is, and they never tell you the details. Or they gave you the book with all the instructions, what's your job is going to be, but you never read it. You arrive to another place, and you don't know what you're supposed to do. You don't know where to go, you don't know where to which office, you don't know what computer, you don't know who's your handler, you don't know how to send info, nothing. Why you don't know? Because you never opened the book. Most of the Jewish people in the world never read the Torah once in their entire life. As a matter of fact, one of the worst jokes in history in our days is those Jews who constantly fight against the Torah. All the time. No matter when religion is mentioned, they always have something bad to say. To make fun, nasty comments, rebelling, fighting, trying to prove that it's fairy tales, that it's nothing, or that there's no God, God forbid. These people, one by one, after 25 years of working with the public, I'm telling you, not one of them ever read the Torah from the beginning to the end and can understand the meaning of the verses. Forget the secrets, forget Kabbalah, forget Gemara, forget Mishnah, forget Rambam, Halachot, Zohar, forget all that. That's a whole different level. I'm talking level of first grade. Like you put a kid in 6 years old in yeshiva, first year, what did they teach him? Aleph, Bet, Gimel. By the end of the year, they read the Chumash. First parasha, second parasha. After 3-4 years, they finish the whole Chumash. They can tell you the meaning of the verses of each parasha and parasha. All together, there are a few thousand verses in the Torah. They can take each verse and tell you just the simple explanation, what it means. Literally. I'm not talking about the secrets. I'm not talking gematria. I'm not talking midrashim. I'm not talking why this word appear here like this. And everything that we learn in yeshiva for 40, 50 years. I'm not talking about this. I'm only talking 6 years old level. Include the Prime Minister of Israel. Include the President of Israel. Include the head judge of the Israeli Supreme Court. Include all the pilots of the F-16, all the general, all the commando, all the SEALs, all the professors in university, all the cardiologists, all the doctors, all the movie stars, all the talk show hosts. All of them 100% have zero knowledge in Judaism. Zero knowledge. Not even 1%. I would love to give them 5%, 10%, but they have no knowledge. They never read the Torah once in their life. I'm talking in today's generation. 7 years ago, it wasn't the case. A lot of secular people, they knew some of the Torah. They learned when they were young. They were in yeshivot, especially the Yemenite Israeli. Up to a certain age, they knew how to read the whole Torah by heart. But today, it's a disaster. The new generation, everyone that is 50 years old and younger, never ever read the Torah. But they have speeches against the Torah non-stop, all their life, and they never read the Torah once in their life. Now you tell me if you ever heard a bigger joke than this. It's a very sad joke. For instance, nobody criticized Shakespeare. Why? I never read Shakespeare. Why would I go against him? Why would I speak against him? Let me first read, few times I read his book, I understand what's going on, then I can tell you what the problems over there, if there are problems. If I will come and criticize Shakespeare for 3 hours, And the professor will get up and say, excuse me, sir, you have a lot of complaints against Shakespeare. Can you tell us which book you're talking about and how many times you read that book? To be honest with you, Mr. Professor, I never opened a book of Shakespeare in my life. Don't know even when he lived. I don't know what the names of his book. I never ever held a book of him in my hand. So the professor will say, excuse me, maybe you need a mental institution. You just gave us a 3-hour speech against Shakespeare, and after that you admit that you don't even know who he is. You never read his book. How do you dare to speak against something you don't have any idea what it is? This is the question that I have to each one of you. Maybe in Brazil people have more class, and they don't speak against the Torah, at least not in public. And they don't write in the internet all kinds of poison against the Torah. Maybe they respect more the rabbis and the religion. Maybe, I don't know. But I'm talking from a point of view of Israeli, what happened now in Israel, every second. And in Israel, at least half of the country is fighting against the Torah like it's the biggest enemy of their life. Big hatred to the Torah, to the religion, and to the religious people. And none of them even know what the Torah is. They don't know anything. They don't know the mitzvot. They don't understand. If they would watch my film, Torah and Science, which happened thousands of times to people, they will feel so ashamed after they finish the film, so ashamed of themselves, they would cry out of embarrassment. How many hundreds of emails I got from people watch one lecture of mine. One lecture, not even without proof, just a lecture about life. And after that they sent me an email, I'm so ashamed how I've been speaking until now. Now for the first time in my life I understood what does it mean religion. What does it mean to be Jewish? What does it mean God? I'm so ashamed by the way I used to think, by the way my ideology used to be. In one lecture of an hour and a half, you changed my entire view of the Torah, of Judaism. And it's not me. It's the information from the Torah. Oh, for the first time, I once was invited to speak in New Jersey, not far from New York, in a house of a husband and wife. The wife was sitting Shiva, lo aleinu, over there. Her father died, and she was sitting Shiva in her house. They told me, are you available to come to speak? I say, yes. So it's going to be 150 secular Israeli men and women here. It's a chance to give an hour speech to wake them up, to show them that they live in a dream. They live in illusion. This illusion eventually will explode in their face and they're going to have to pay for all their sins, which can come to millions of sins. And the punishment will be so severe. Who is going to save these ignorant people from their dream? Are you coming? I say, yes, I'm coming. I went there. I spoke for maybe an hour and a half. There was one Arab Druzi over there, Goy, friend of the Israelis. The Druzis and the Israelis are very good friends. He got up in the middle, took care of the kippah, put it on a chair. He said, I have to go. This was maybe half an hour into the speech. If I stay here another 10 minutes, I must convert to Judaism. So his friend told him, so what are you afraid of? If that's the truth, convert. He said, they'll kill me in my village, my father and my family, they'll kill me over there. So I have to go. He just couldn't stay. Why? Because he already saw the truth of the Torah. That's the only truth of God. But that's not what I wanted to focus on. The reason I bring this lecture up, there was a husband and wife over there. Couple of Ashkenazi couple, very educated. Reality, they look such nice people. Speak to them very polite, educated people, gentle. They came to me after the lecture. They say, Rabbi, we are shocked. It's all in Hebrew. We are shocked. We got the shock of our life. I say, why? He said, that's the first time in our life we heard a speech of Torah. We never heard anybody speak. We never heard Torah. We never learned Torah. We are the couple that opened the party in Israeli Knesset that called Shinui. Shinui means a change. This party today have 17 people sitting in the Knesset. They have only one agenda. That's it. They talk about nothing besides one thing, to destroy the Torah and Judaism. That's all they care about. They don't speak about social issues. Everything that is against the Torah, they are for it. They want gay parades, they want gay marriage, they want to transportation on Shabbat, they want to cancel Brit Milah, they want to allow chametz in restaurants, everything against the Torah. That's why they were elected. Help us to release you from the religion. That's what they said to the voters. Who was the first one who gave them the push? It was an Israeli journalist on television. His name was Tommy Lapid. Maybe the most wicked guy in the history of Israel, the modern Israel. The way he was speaking against Jews and against the Torah was mamash similar to the Nazis, how the Nazis used to speak against the Jews. So this couple, they started this party, that was their idea, and they saw they're not getting enough votes to get into the government. So they went to this Tommy Lapid and they convinced him to join them and take over the party because he was very famous. He has a talk show. Come, take it. You also have the same ideology like us. You also hate religion. You want to cancel the religion. Come, be the leader of Shinui. They brought him in. He got 15 seats. Now his son is the one who continues his legacy. They started it, but they never in their life heard a word of religion. But they decided to stop the religion not knowing what it is. Baruch Hashem, when they spoke to me, they were so ashamed. I said, what are we going to do now? I said, why don't we start with you making a lecture to you and your friends in your house? Would you come? I said, yes. I went to their house, I spoke there. I spoke a few times over there. I made both of them fully Orthodox. Shomer Shabbat, Kashrut, the woman, modesty, the guy put tzitzit, put kippah, go to shul every day. Completely religious they became. Why is it? In a period of a month and a half, they became fully Orthodox because they started to listen to lectures. I gave them CDs. Every day they will learn more and more. They were so innocent. The more they heard, the more they realize their mistake. This is more or less the situation of almost all the Jews in the world. They speak very much against the Torah, or they avoid the Torah, or they resist the Torah, and they don't have any idea what the Torah is. You, in Brazil over there, I don't know any one of you. Not personally, not generally, I don't know. I don't even know who I'm talking to. I only know that some of the listeners right now are not Shomer Mitzvot. They don't keep Shabbat. Maybe they don't keep kosher. Maybe they don't keep the holidays. I don't know. Some probably keep more, some keep less. Whatever the case is, it's nothing personal. I have a deal to offer each one of you with a guarantee. I say that after you watch my film Torah and Science or you read my book, I have a book, Preparation for Eternal Life. It's written in English, in Hebrew, and now we made Russian and Spanish as well. So once you read it, you will get the whole picture. You will understand how we know for sure that the Torah is 100% from God. You will know 100% the purpose of life. Because today nobody knows the purpose of life. If you stand on a street of Tel Aviv and speak to 1 million Israeli in a week, 1 million Israelis. You stand with a microphone and a camera, one by one on the street. Excuse me, tell us what's the purpose of life. Nobody knows, I promise you. Now one person will know from 1 million people. Nobody would know from the secular people. They will say to make money, to be successful, to gain education, to get married and have children, to be a movie star, to be a soccer player, to be a model, to be a politician, to enjoy food, to enjoy vacation, to what? They don't know. They have no idea. Everybody will say something. One person loves money, say the purpose of life is to be rich. If the purpose of life is to be rich, why 90% of the people in the world are not rich? What's going on? So what? Whoever made the world made 10% enjoy the world and 90% suffer? So obviously that's not fair. It cannot be. So what's the purpose of the life? to be healthy, to watch your health. Almost every person is sick in some sickness. Sugar, cancer, anxiety attack, panic attack, depression, ulcer, so many diseases. That cannot be the purpose. Okay, so the purpose is to get married. A large portion of the Jewish people are single. Boys, girls, millions are not married. In the whole world, billions. Over a billion people are not married or divorced. So if that's the purpose of life, it cannot be. So many people do not find a soulmate. Okay. So the purpose of life maybe is to have children. A lot of couples that got married cannot have children. And those who are single don't have children. So that's not the purpose. So what's the purpose? To gain education. Half of the people in the world have no college education. They can't even afford to go. So that's not the purpose. So maybe the purpose is to be a great athlete. Some people cannot even look at sport. And they cannot definitely be an athlete. So that's not the purpose. So what's the purpose? To be a politician? Most of the people are not. To be a professor? To be a pilot? What is the purpose of life? Nobody knows. To eat? Some, you know how many millions of people starving? They don't have one spoon of rice a day? Look at Africa, what's going on. Millions of people. So what is the purpose? Nobody knows. Now, some people would say, okay, the purpose is probably to be a good person. Now the question will be, what does it mean to be a good person? What does it mean? The Palestinian Hamas murderers, they think they are good people. Every time they kill Jewish children, they think it's a good thing that they do. The Nazis thought the same thing. Jews have their own things. The Israeli think what's good, the Americans think what's good. Everybody thinks about a different good. You ask an American guy, what does it mean to be a good person? To watch football, smoke grass all day and be in a good mood and eat potato chips and hot dogs and beer. That means to be a good person. Or Robin Hood would say, to be a good person is to steal from the rich and give to the poor. Everyone will define good in a different way. There's going to be one million different goods. He thinks this is good and he thinks this is good. Everyone will think good is something else. Racism is good or not? Depend who you ask. You ask the Nazi, he will tell you, of course it's a good thing. You have to clean the bed from the world. You got to get rid of the Jews. You got to get rid of the blacks. You got to get rid of a lot of other ones. This is the way he thinks is good. And other people would think good is something else. Some people think good is to have mercy on the murderers. Not to kill them, not to execute them, to give them food, to give them great condition in jail. To give them education, that when they come out, they'll be even a more sophisticated criminals. Everyone will say good is something else. Some people will say good is to be a doctor who make abortions. What's the problem? I help the woman. She doesn't want a baby. It's a social party. She doesn't have enough money. She came to me. I do a mitzvah. I take the baby, chop him to pieces. After 3 months of pregnancy, when you have pulse and brain waves and everything, and you already drink and eat, I chop him to pieces, I vacuum everything out, I throw it into a garbage can, and I sell it to China. And the Chinese cook it and eat it, or eat it raw. It's not a joke. I saw in my own eyes the presentation, how they sell it. It comes in big, huge black bags of organs from abortion from the United States, exported to China, and they eat it. When I say that 15 years ago in my lecture, people wanted to stone me. Now I believe that they got the point after Corona and what we saw, what they eat over there. It makes a lot more sense. I saw it 20 years ago in a presentation. You know, so the idea is, what really is good? We will never know. The only way to know is first to recognize the creator of the world. And if the world has an order and is designed, there's oxygen everywhere, water everywhere, food, fruits, vegetables, everything is super, super beautiful. And the trees, just the trees. You walk here in New York, in upstate, you look at 50 different colors of trees. You look at the leaves, the design. It's unbelievable design. You look at the lakes around here. You look at the deer. You see all the animals coming here. You cannot believe it. See such a creation. Obviously, somebody made it. Nobody can make a brain of a human being by a random explosion or by millions of years of evolution. There's no such thing. whoever claimed that the world was made by a random Big Bang or millions of years of development, is, they all know it's baloney. Nobody really believed this nonsense. Somebody designed this world. Call him whatever you want. It doesn't really matter. Someone made the world. If there is a creation, there is a creator. The more sophisticated the creation is, it shows who is the creator, how brilliant he is. To make a table, no big deal. You don't have to be a genius. To make a laptop, you have to be a lot smarter. To make a human brain, 10 trillion connection. You know what it is? Do you know how microscopic it is? The wires in the brain, one wire, 1,000 wires from the brain combined is one hair from your head. Pull out one hair, look at that in the sun, you can see it. Take a magnifying glass, look at your hair. Take 1,000 wires from a brain, put them together, like one, parallel. Attach them together. That's how thick one hair is. One hair equal to 1,000 veins, wires in the brain. The size of a brain, size of an apple. 80% of it is liquid. Only 20% is those wires. And inside, they connect with each other 10 trillion times. Do you know what 10 trillion is? 10 billion multiplied by 1,000. 10 billion, 9 zeros after the 1. 10 is 10 digits. Add 3 more zeros. 13 digits. This is just one brain multiplied by 7 billion people. 2 million different kinds of animals. Monkey, giraffe, lion, tigers, bears. They all also have brains. Take all of this creation. It was made by someone. Now, the question is, who made this creation? The answer, and why? Excuse me? No, show me. So, I'm almost finished. I just want to make this point clear, and then I can maybe give time for questions. So, the point is, if there is a creation, there is a creator. The more sophisticated the creation is, the more brilliant the creator is. We never found a creation without a purpose. You ask the carpenter, why you made this table? To eat on it, to write on it, that's why it's in the right size. A chair, to sit and to lean back. Bottle of water, you have a bottle of water. This bottle of water, do you know how long they planned it? Look at all these lines for the hands to hold it, place for the sticker, place for the lid, the bottom to be stable that it won't fall. Everything was designed. So first, you know what you want. After you know what you want, you begin to plan how to make what you want. And then you go into making it. Once you make it, it's for the purpose of what you want. So now, if God made this world and he made people which control all the animals, control all the raw material, control the whole world, control the trees, the fruits, the vegetables, everything in the world was made for me, for the human being. It's obvious. You can see right away. I control, I use it. I can plant seeds, I can cut them, I can plant trees, I can cut them, I can kill them, I can kill animals, I can make animals have more babies. I control everything. So everything was made for me. What is my purpose? If you say that my purpose is to eat, I would be a monkey. They also eat. If the purpose is to have intimacy, I would be a monkey. They also have intimacy. If the purpose was to enjoy the world, the monkeys enjoy it much better. They're in nature, they jump on the trees, free, they don't have to work 30 years for the mortgage, they don't have stress, you never saw a monkey that is bald, you never saw a monkey with gray hair. They enjoy life. Look at the birds here, they come here to the garbage, they open the garbage, they eat the squirrels, the deer, they eat the leaves around, they enjoy life. They have no problem, no stress, an unlimited amount of food for them, just eat as much as you want. They have babies as much as they want. A minute after the baby is born, he's running. They don't have diapers. They don't have to cook food for them. They don't have to stand Today I went to buy some food for Shabbat. Half an hour I stood online just to enter Costco. Half an hour. Just to enter the store. Why? Now until you buy is another hour. Until you arrive home, another 20 minutes. Until you take it out of the car, another 10 minutes. Until you cook it, another hour. All of that for one meal. They don't have this. They get up, they run, they eat, whatever they want. Easy life. The egos flying all over. They don't care. Corona, quarantine, they don't have problems. They fly, no border check, no border is closed. They fly anywhere they want, they eat whatever they want, they enjoy life. So why are we better than the animals? The answer, we're not. Everything we have, they have it easier. They're stronger, they're faster, they have more abilities, they can move faster. So what if everything was made for me, what is my purpose? The answer, everything I say until now, you can understand even without Torah. You know there is a creator because you see the world. You know the world was made for a purpose. You know everything was made for the human being. You know the human being is the most important thing in a creation. You know for sure there is some kind of purpose in the world, but you just don't know what is the purpose. But you understand logically that whoever made me wants something. He wouldn't put me here just to eat and to drink. That's where the Torah comes into place. Until here, everybody knows it. Jews, non-Jews, every person that have sechel, that have brain, gets the point. But from here on, you cannot move another inch without Judaism. You can't. You need now to begin to read the Torah. First, the beginning of the Torah, how God created Adam and Eve, how He created the world, how He created Adam and Eve, and He told them what's the purpose. And later in the Torah, you read that the purpose of life is, I put you here for X amount of years, I put your soul inside your body. The body worth $3 in a lab. Mineral, salt, iron, water. The value of a body in a lab is $3. Slice of pizza. But the soul worth trillions. Endless amount. And the soul is not physical. It does not have limitation. The soul has no limitation. The soul is a divine energy that God puts in the body of a person. The soul is in the body, as it's written in the Torah, that God blew the soul into Adam's nostrils, from the nose. Like you fill up air in a balloon. Once this soul entered the body, Vayia Adam lenefesh chaya, he became alive. The Gemara say he was able to talk, to understand, to remember, Ruach memalela. And he started to live. Then the Torah say, I am testing you every day of your life, every hour of your life. Ki menaseh Hashem etchem, I'm testing you. How am I testing you? I gave you the Torah in a public event. I spoke to you in Mount Sinai. I made a covenant with you, like a wedding, like a husband and wife. I made a covenant with you. I gave you my most precious thing, which is the Torah. I order you to teach your children my Torah from generation to generation, to appreciate that I took you out of Egypt. I am your God that took you out of Egypt to be your God. Ani Hashem Elokechem, asher hoceti etchem eretz Mitzrayim liyot lachem leElokim. The only reason I saved you from slavery, from Egypt, is for one reason. To be your God, and you be my children. It's written right after that. Banim atem laHashem Elokechem. I chose you from all the nations to be my children. You are the chosen people. You must be holy because I'm holy. Kedoshim tiyu ki kadosh ani. You cannot be like the goyim. You cannot dress like them. You cannot call your children with their names. You cannot eat their food. You cannot marry them. You must be isolated for them. En am lebadad ishkon ubagoyim lo itchashav. This is a nation that will always be isolated and will not have anything to do with this goyim. No matter how brilliant you be, when you rich, they hate you. When you poor, they hate you. When you contribute to the world, they hate you. When you contribute less, they hate you. When you live in Israel, they hate you. When you go to exile, they hate you. When they kill you, they still hate you. No matter what, Esav Sonel Yaakov, I, God, make them always hate you. Of course, not all of them. There's a lot of good goyim. I met a huge amount of good goyim. But it's enough that 15%, 20% will hate you. It's already hundreds of millions of people. They're all over the world. It will be very difficult. They in the media, they in the internet, they in politics. I don't have to tell you. Look at the United Nations. You'll get the point. All the haters of the Jews gather into one building. No matter what the Torah say, they will always be jealous with you. They will always hate you. Why is it? Because I chose you and not them. And I gave you my Torah. And you are the chosen people. And you are special to me. And your land is a special land for me. Eretz asher enei Hashem Elokecha ba mirashit ha-shana v'ad acharit ha-shana. This is all clear verses in the Torah. So all we have to do now, Rabotai, is only one thing. To prove that the Torah can never be written by human being. Never. And I started to give an example, and I'll finish it, and we'll finish right here. The Torah said to the Jews, everything that have scales and fins, you're allowed to eat. Comes the oral Torah and say a statement that only God could have said such thing. No human being was able to write such a thing. Guarantee. What does it say? Kol sheyesh lo kaskeset, yesh lo snapir. Everything that have scales always will have fins. Always. No matter what you take out of the water, if you scrape it and scales are falling off, for sure this species will also have fins. You will never find a star in the sea that have scales that falls like a fish, because if you will find something like this, that means the Torah made a mistake, the oral Torah, because the Torah say everything that have scales must have fins, and a star doesn't have fins. Or a snake. You have a log snake in the water, there are many snakes. If one of the snakes will have scales that you scrape it and they fall off, and he finish with a tail, it doesn't have fins, that will be the end of Judaism. If a horse, there's a horse in the ocean, it looks like a horse, if he will have fins, that's the end of Judaism. Why? Because it doesn't have fins. If you would have scales, it doesn't have fins. So the Torah took a huge risk. The Torah said to the Jewish people, you want to know what's kosher? If you take something out of the ocean and it has fins and scales, it's kosher. Then the oral Torah come and say something even more special. You don't need to see the old fish. You go to Chinatown, let's say this is the fish, this is the head. You come to Chinatown, they sell you only half a fish. You don't see the scales. Let's say over here at the fins. You have fins over here. You come to the Chinese guy, he gives you half a fish. You don't see if this fish has fins or not. You don't know. You see half a salmon fish, half. You see the head and you see half of the body. You see that in the body they have scales. Where are the fins? A different customer bought it. You don't know. It's okay, it's kosher for sure. Why? If it has scales in the body, for sure it also had fins. I am the creator of the world. I made all the water. I made all the species in the water. I control all the future. And I'm telling you, you will never ever find something like this in the entire world. Never. Now remember, when the Torah was given to the Jews, half of the species that lives in the ocean today did not even exist. They always mix together and create new species. Even in labs in Israel, in Florida, in other places, scientists always mix between species and they create new species all the time. Even those species must fall into the same rule. If it has scales, it must have fins. If one person will find something in the ocean that have scales and did not have fins, that's the end of the whole Torah. No more Torah, no more Shabbat, no more Yom Kippur, no more Shema Yisrael, no more Tfilin, no more nothing. Why? Because in a divine book that is from God, you can never find mistakes. Not even one mistake. Not even one mistake. When you open the New Testament of the Christians, every page has mistakes. For instance, it's written over there that the cave of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Me'arat HaMachpelah, it's in the city of Shechem, Nablus. Where is it? In Hebron. Every fool knows it. Go all over the world today, ask people, where is it? In Hebron. But in the New Testament of the Christian, which they claim it's part two of the same God, it's written that it's in Shechem. They made a mistake. The person that wrote it, obviously it's not God, he copied from the Torah, but he got mixed between the grave of Joseph, which is in Shechem, to the grave of Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, that is in Hebron. That's one typical mistake. They also have another mistake, that they say that Jacob went to Egypt with 75 people. But in the Torah it says 70. And they claim it's the same Torah, part one, part two. What happened to God? He forgot? If it was 70 people or 75? There are so many ridiculous mistakes in Christianity that you begin to laugh. Literally, you begin to laugh. You say, how can it be that 2 billion people follow this joke? It's such a joke. But it is what it is. Why people follow it? Everything is allowed. You do whatever you want. If you murder someone, come to the priest, give him $50. Chatati, aviti, pashati, father, don't worry. Tov. Islam, more serious religion. They really more devoted to God. It's different. It's not as bad as Christianity. Also much less mistakes. But there are also human mistakes. They say in the Quran that Haman and Pharaoh had a meeting to go make a building and fight against the God of the Jews. Haman was 1,000 years after Pharaoh, the last Pharaoh. Haman and Pharaoh could never meet. Maybe in hell they met, but not in this world. Haman and Pharaoh can never meet. The fool that wrote that did not know history. When he saw in the Torah that there was Pharaoh in Egypt and he was a bad man, and he saw in Megillat Esther there was another bad man named Haman, he decided to create a fairy tale. Haman and Pharaoh having a meeting. Right? What's the meeting? Obama and the president of Iran has a meeting. What's the purpose of the meeting? How we can hurt Israel. There's only one problem. If Obama and the president of Iran met, it's fine. They will live in the same generation. But can Obama meet with Hitler? No, Hitler was 60 years before Obama, 7 years before Obama, so it cannot be, that's it. Yeah, very simple. Also, according to the Quran, they made a huge mistake between two Miriam. There's Miriam, the mother of JC, that lived 2,000 years ago. And there's Miriam, the sister of Moshe and Aaron. Miriam, the daughter of Amram. Two different Miriam. They live 1,300 years apart from each other. So in the Quran, the two Miriam became one woman. According to the Quran, the biggest joke in history. According to the Quran, the uncle of JC, the false Messiah of the Christians, the uncle of JC is Moshe Rabbeinu and Aaron. And his mother is Miriam, the sister of Moshe. Miriam bat Amram. Miriam, she passed in the desert. She didn't enter Israel. She was a prophet. She never knew she had a son called JC. You know, but the Christian knows better. She all of a sudden became the mother of JC, even though he was born 1,300 years after her. Such ridiculous mistakes. Few days ago, last Sunday, 4 days ago, I got a call from a very smart doctor from Saudi Arabia. Very, very nice person. Very smart person, and also very decent person. We spoke about religion. He found me, he sent me an email because he started to listen to my series about relationship, finding your soulmate. It's called Psychology of the Mind and the Soul, Relationship, Marriage, How to Prepare for Marriage, How to Act in a Marriage, to make your life a lot better. So this is the series. So far, I think I made 9 lectures in English and 7 in Hebrew. I'm about to finish that series. He'd been listening to it on YouTube. He said to me, I thought you're a Muslim preacher. Because this is what we learn. We also learn about modesty, about this, about marriage, about all these things. Then I realized, you're a rabbi. Started to talk on the phone. He asked me if he can call me on the phone. I gave him my number. He called me up. We spoke for about 40 minutes. After all the, we found out, it's sad to admit, but if all the Israeli Jews in Israel would have his ideology, this Arab doctor, the Mashiach would come already 1,000 years ago. Everything he was saying, mamash like a Talmid Yeshiva, about marriage, about loyalty, about modesty, about the belief in God, about faith, about parnasa, everything the same. Mamash like this. It's like you think somebody came out of yeshiva and talk about it. But then I gave him the punchline. After the whole conversation, I told him, since you are a very honest man, I want to ask you one question. What's the question? You believe the Quran is the word of God and it was given to Muhammad and you think Muhammad is the prophet. Please find me one prophecy in the whole Quran. I'll give you a price. Find me one prophecy. Don't show me parts of the Quran that copy the Torah. That's speaking about Pharaoh and speaking about Moshe, how Hashem told the Jews that he's going to give them Israel. This is from the Torah. Everybody can copy it. Don't show me parts in the Quran that they copy from the Jewish prophet. Isaiah, Yechezkel. Forget about this. Show me one prophecy that Muhammad gave. I already know there's not one prophecy in the Quran. How you can call him Prophet Muhammad when he never gave one prophecy? The Torah is full of prophecies. The Torah said to the Jewish people, I'm going to bring you into Israel. I'm going to give you the Holy Land. There are seven nations sitting there right now. Prizi, Girgashi, Yevusi, Chivi, Kna'ani. All these nations are there. There are seven nations in Israel with seven armies. And you, what kind of power you have? You were slaves in Egypt. You were 40 years in the desert. All the people that came out of Egypt died besides two, Yoshua, Ben-Nun, and Caleb. It's a new generation. They all grew in the desert. They don't know how to fight. They don't know anything. They have to go now into Israel. And the Torah promised, I'm going to give you their land. I will throw them out of the land of Canaan, which is Israel, and I will give you the land. And I'm going to do it not because you deserve it, because they are worse than you. You are wicked, but they are much more wicked, these goyim. So I throw them out of my land. I am the master of the land. I throw them out. And I will give you the land. And the reason I'm giving you the land is because I made a promise to your father, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that I will give the land to their children, and I will make a covenant with their children, and I will never replace them with any other nation. Clearly, it's written in the Torah. And it's written also in the Torah, Af al pi biyotam beretz oyveim. Even though I'm going to spread you later in the nations in exile, אף על פי ביותם בארץ אויביהם לא מאסתים ולא גאלתים לחלותם. I will not be that disgusted from them to destroy them from the face of the earth completely. I will not do that. Why? Because I sworn to Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, I'll never destroy them and I will never replace them with any other nation. So now, I will bring you into Israel. I will let you kick them out. You will inherit the land. You will build the temple in a place I will show you. I will live among you. I will bless you. Everything will be the land of milk and honey. But if you don't listen to me and you don't follow my Torah and my commandments, I will be that angry at you. I will stop the sky. There will not be rain. Everybody will be hungry. The animals will not have what to eat. Until you're going to be destroyed from the face of the earth. I will throw you out of Israel. I will spread you among the nations. Only few of you will survive. And where you're going to live, you would live with fear from the goyim that will chase you. And even when they don't chase you, you'll still live in panic. Everything happened in details. I will send a nation from far away that you don't recognize their language. They will come all the way. They have no mercy on women and children. They will come to destroy the temple. They will put you on boats. They will take you to Egypt. Who needs boats? To Egypt you can walk. 3 days you walk, you're in Egypt. Why bringing from Rome, from Italy, boats, putting the Jewish prisoners on a boat and go all the way to Egypt? What for? Make a line, start walking to Egypt. You can walk to Egypt, you have a border. You know, so why do you need boats? That's exactly what the Romans did. They brought boats, they put prisoners, they took them. And when they take you to Egypt, no one would be interested to buy you. You will be sold for a price of 1 meal of a horse. And that's exactly what happened. A nation that is symbol is eagle. The Romans were eagle. They destroyed the second temple. The Babylonians, their symbol was eagle. They destroyed the first temple. The Russians, their symbol is eagle. The Americans, their symbol is eagles. All the empires. The Nazis, their symbol was eagle. All the empires, all the countries who dominate the world, all of them have the same size eagle, either in the flag or in their symbol of their land. Unbelievable. Size of an eagle. This is it. The Torah says they will come like an eagle from far into your land, and this is what they're going to do. What human being would be able to know such thing? What human being can promise the nation of Israel, I'm going to bring you into Israel and I kick 7 nations out? If I come today to a group of people with women and children and I say to them, I will help you to win against China, against Russia, against United States, against Germany, against France, against England, I will help you to kick them all out from a place where they are, and you're going to take the land. They will tell me, you're dreaming. How exactly are you going to do it? We don't have horses like them. We don't have weapons like them. We don't have soldiers like them. And we are with our babies and our children. How are we going to go into the war with them? They're sitting there for who knows how many years. That's what the Torah promised. And that's exactly what happened. Everything the Torah said, I have a whole lecture about the prophecies. One by one, I show how it all happened. One last thing, the Torah promised that the Western world will never fall down. It's written in Shir HaShirim. It's a part of the Tanakh. It's the last book out of 24 books of the Tanakh. It's Song of Songs, King Solomon, 3,000 years ago. And it's written over there that the Western world, in Ezeh Omed Achar Kotlenu, it's speaking in a present language, here is the wall always standing, will never fall down. Why? Because God sworn to that wall that it will never ever fall down. Let's see. 2,000 years from the destruction of the second temple, the wall is still standing. When the Romans destroyed Beit HaMikdash, they knocked down the 3 other walls, but they did not touch the western wall. Very interesting. There was a general, his name was Fanger. He decided to leave that wall. He said to the soldier, don't knock this wall, that everybody will know what we destroyed. When they found out he did not knock the wall, they killed him. But the wall was standing. The Babylonians that came earlier to destroy the temple also did not touch the Western wall, surprisingly. The Muslims, the Ottomans, the Persians, the Armenians, the Seljukim, the Turks, all these empires that came and occupied Jerusalem, they all lived there, nobody touched the Western Wall. There was a huge earthquake in Yerushalayim, all the buildings fell down, the Western Wall is still standing. At one point in history, the Western Wall was covered with sand. They had to dig it to find it. It was entirely in the ground. If you go underneath the ground, you see the rest of the Kotel underneath. For those of you who went to Jerusalem on a tour, God swore that this wall will never fall down. Now remember, the bricks of the Western Wall do not have cement to glue it. It's one brick on top of the other. One tiny shaking and it all falls down. The Arabs that stands on top, they bring a tractor, they push the top bricks, everything will fall on us. But the Arabs never knocked it down. As a matter of fact, when they wanted to build the mosque, Salah Adin, all these people, they wanted to build the Al-Aqsa mosque, it was very, very high. The old Arabs, they could not climb, like it's like 20 floors. How are they going to go all the way up to the mosque? The floor of Jerusalem was a lot lower. The Arabs say, how are we going to get all the way up to the mountain? It's too high for us. So they had two options. One option is to shave the mountain, to bring it down. Make it much, much lower. The other option was to bring down the entire Jerusalem higher. What makes more sense? To shave a mountain 400 by 400, to bring 1,000 Arabs with shovels, and they take the sand down in 2 or 3 weeks, they make it much, much, much lower, and like this, instead of going 10 flights up, you go 5 flights up. In 2 weeks, you finish the job. To make the entire Jerusalem higher, it can take years. You need a lot more work. Surprisingly, they brought everything up, but they didn't touch the mountain. If you go under the land, under the ground, you see they made arches, and they made another floor, and they made arches again, and they made another floor. They brought it up by a lot, the floor of Jerusalem. Why? That the people that build their homes there, it won't be so much to climb. Why they did not bring down the mountain? Because there's one verse in the Tanakh. If they would bring down the mountain, the western wall is the side of the mountain. It would go down with it. They shaved the wall. The wall will go lower and lower and lower until it will go all the way to the bottom. But God promised the western wall will never fall. Do you know one human being that can take such a risk? Especially when the Goyim, all they wanted is to destroy Beit HaMikdash, as we see in history. Why for 2,000 years they never touched that wall? The answer, one promise in the Torah. And I can give you thousands of examples like this. If you watch my film, Torah and Science, if you watch my film, Torah and Science number 2, if you've watched my lecture, Wisdom in Chazal, if you watch my movie, The Purpose of Life, or Life After Death, after you watch these famous movies that I made, you won't have 1% doubt that there is a God. The Torah was given to us in a public event, the written and the oral Torah. Every second of our life is a test. Every Jew, not only the rabbis, every Jew, boy, girl, smart, stupid, rich, poor, healthy, sick, doesn't matter. Every Jew must keep the laws of the Torah. Most of the laws of the Torah right now are not relevant because there's no temple. You don't have sacrifices, none of these things that used to do in Beit HaMikdash. This is right there, hundreds of commandments that are less. Some commandments are only if you are a boss and you have workers. Some commandments is only for women. Some commandments is only for men. Women are not obligated. Like tefillin, like brit milah, like, things like that. Some commandments is once a year, like eating matzah, once a year, one day a year. Sitting in a sukkah, one time a year. Lulav, one time a year. There's a lot of mitzvot that comes once a year. Some mitzvot once every 7 years, like Shemitah. One mitzvah of Yovel, once every 50 years. Overall, some of these mitzvot are not relevant today. How many mitzvot we have today? 50, 60, 70 mitzvot all together annually. And people are too spoiled. What's so difficult? What's so bad about resting on Shabbat? One day you don't drive. One day you don't turn every electric fire. What's the big deal? We enjoy very much Shabbat. One day you are with the family, you eat well, you come to shul, you meet friends, families, you sing, you dress nice. A holiday every week. What's the big deal? Electric timers turn everything on and off. Today, much easier. Turn this on, cook this for me, do this for me, special Shabbos elevate. Everything is easy today. Very, very easy. To keep Shabbat, very easy. What? People afraid of what they don't know. Once they begin to be serious, they get into the Torah, they learn, at least they understand the purpose of life. If they will not learn the purpose of life, they won't read the Torah. If they won't read at least Sefer Dvarim, Deuteronomy, how else in the world they will know what they live for? They will never know in their entire life what's the purpose. They will never have relationship with their own creator. He gives them oxygen. He gives them water. He gives them food. He gives them a place to live. Most people have cars. They have nice clothes. He gives them wife or husband or children. Whatever he gives people, whatever they get from him, they don't ever say thank you. They don't ever appreciate it. And not only that, they take everything and use it against him. He gave you brain with intelligence, you use it against him to speak against the Torah and against the religion and against the rabbi. He gave you money, you take the money, you buy non-kosher food, you pay for all kinds of forbidden things, you go to places you're not supposed to be, you buy clothes that are not modest, that everybody would look at you if you're a woman, and you be machtiyat arabim, you make other people do, make all kinds of sins. Everything he gave you, you use it against you, against him. He gave you a nice car, you drive it on Shabbat. Not allowed, the Torah says it cannot create fire on Shabbat. You turn the engine of the car, it's like 5,000 cigarettes a second. Some people say to me, I don't smoke on Shabbat. I don't turn the fire on. But you drive the car? Yeah. I drive to shul. Starting the car, it's like 5,000 cigarettes every second. So if you drive 40 minutes or 20 minutes to the shul, that's millions of turning the fire millions of times just to get to shul. And then millions of times to come back. Why do you need to come to shul? Pray at home. The Torah says you're not allowed to create fire. You cannot break Shabbat. Shabbat is the eternal covenant between God and the Jewish children. For those of you who did Kiddush, even once in their life, when you hold the cup of wine, what do we say in a Kiddush? Veshamru bnei Israel et haShabbat. And the nation of Israel observed the Sabbath. La'asot et haShabbat ledorotam brit olam. To make the Sabbath an eternal covenant. Beini uven bnei Israel oti le'olam. Between me and the nation of Israel, it's a sign for eternity. Forever. Ot I le'olam. Ot, sign for what? Ki sheshet yamim asa Hashem et ha-shamayim ve'et ha-aretz, uvayom ha-shvi shavat v'inafash. That 6 days God made heaven and earth and the entire world, and in the seventh day he rested. What does it say right after that in the Torah? Mechaleleha mot yumat. Those Jews who will violate the holiness of the Sabbath will make it a weekday. Mechaleleha come from the word chol. Chol, yom chol means a weekday, regular day. Mechaleleha, someone that will ignore this order and will behave on Shabbat like a regular day, work, driving, smoking, telephone, computer, television, all these things. Mechaleleha mot yumat will be put to death earlier in this world and will be put to death in the next world, which is eternal world. Ve'nichreta ha'nefesh ha'im me'ameha. And that soul, I will cut that soul from the nation of Israel for eternity. Ve'nichreta, that's onesh karet. Such a horrible punishment, just for some stupid transaction, starting a car, driving a car, cooking an omelet. We eat very well on Shabbat. Put everything, there's fire, put a blech or electric plata. You have everything you want. As a matter of fact, we eat non-stop on Shabbos. One meal and another meal and 10 different kinds of salads and meat and chicken and fish and all kinds of dessert. That's what it's all about. You enjoy, you get people, you talk, you sleep, you rest, you take a walk, you come to shul, you learn Torah. Fantastic. Fantastic. Every one of my Baal Tshuva, I asked him over the years, how is it after you keep Shabbat for a few weeks already? It's amazing. Heaven. I just wait right away for the next Shabbat. Those who don't keep, because they don't know what they miss. If they would give it a chance 3 months, it takes time to get used to a new lifestyle, yes. But after that, you can live without it. And that's a fact. Bezrat Hashem, I hope that all of you over there, first I hope everyone stayed. This will be on YouTube, not tomorrow. Tomorrow is Shabbat, but probably Sunday or Monday. This lecture will be on my YouTube page, Rabbi Yosef Mizrachi. If you want to show it to your friends, fine. You don't need this lecture. There's a much better one, as I told you, my film, Torah and Science. Also, the purpose of life. Every one of the Jews that you know, you must share it with them. This is an opportunity to save their souls. We're not talking about saving the body here. If one of your friends needs a kidney, if not, he'll die. You go around, you collect money for him, you do everything you can to save his body. If another person is in prison, you'll do everything you can to collect the money to release him out of jail. This is to save the souls of the brothers and sisters of the Jewish nation from eternal destruction, eternal death. It's written in Prophet Yechezkel that God say, all the times I say in the Torah, death penalty, it's not because I want to kill the dead. I want him to do tshuva that he should live. I want him to make repentance that he should live. And right away you have to ask a question. What does it mean, I'm not interested to kill the dead? How can you kill the dead? He's dead already. Why the Torah use such a language? I'm not interested to kill the dead. I want them to do tshuva. Who? The dead? They're already in a grave. No. Those who are not connected to me, to my Torah, they are considered dead. Their soul is dead. It's not connected to their creator. It's like a phone without a charger. What good is the phone? $2,000 phone, but there's no charger. There's no connection. No connection whatsoever, Rabotai. So what I'm saying here, Rabotai, you have to understand. It's written clearly. I want the dead people to do tshuva, to make repentance, to stop making their sins, to start keeping mitzvot, to start learn my Torah, to connect, that they should live. Meaning right now, what are they? 100% dead. They make money, they run, they play football, they have vacation, they do whatever they want. Dogs also do whatever they want. Monkeys also do whatever they want. Birds also do whatever they want. Just to move doesn't mean you're alive. To talk or to smile or to laugh or to eat, that doesn't mean you are alive. The body is alive, but the soul is totally dead. The only way to save the soul is to connect it to where it came from. Every soul came, it's a spark of God. Man de nafach, mi de leke nafach. The Gemara and the Zohar explain, the one who blew the soul into Adam's body, blew a soul, a piece from himself. A piece of God is in the soul of each one of us. And one day when we die, the soul comes out, as it's written with Rachel in the Torah, a soul came out, and the body died, and Rachel died. The Torah told you, how do you die? The soul comes out, the body goes to the ground, and the soul goes to the master that gave it. And there's 1 year trial. That's why we say Kaddish for 1 year. In Judaism, why you say Kaddish 1 year on the dead people? Why not 1 week? Why not 1 month? Why not 10 years? Why not for the rest of your life? You love your father. You want to say 30 years Kaddish on him. You don't need to. 1 year. Why 1 year? From the minute he died, 1 year trial. 1 year trial. You know what it is? It's not like here. 1 year, that from the 1 year, 99% of the time you don't do anything. You're home until they call you again. This is an intense trial. Every second of your life will be analyzed. Every word, every movement, every transaction, everything you did for good and bad. Et hakol yavi Hashem b'mishpat. Everything will be judged. And then we're going to get your reward or you get your punishment. Depend what you deserve to get. Every person will have to deal with their consequences. The consequences of their choices. We are choosing 100% if to be righteous or wicked. Everything else is not in our hand. We'll be rich or poor, smart, foolish, male, female, born in this country or in that. Nobody asked us anything. Everything was dictated for us, except one thing. To be righteous or to be wicked, it was not decided for you. It's 100% in your hand. And that's why all the judgment is if you were righteous or wicked. Nobody will punish you if you're ugly. Nobody will punish you if you're extra heavy, or you're too skinny, or you're too tall, or you're too short, or if you're born in Israel, or if you're born in America, or if you're born in Brazil, or if you're a male, or if you're a female, or none of it. For that, there's no punishment. Nobody will punish you if you have long nose, or small nose, or blue eyes, or green eyes. or hair, or you bald. No, for that nobody gets punishment. There's only one thing you get punishment: if you're a murderer, if you are mechalel Shabbat, if you are a thief, if you are an idol worshiper, if you rebel against God, if you are ungrateful, if you are a liar. That's what the Torah says. I did not write the Torah, so in case you are upset at what I told you, go to the Western Wall, write a long complaint, and put it by the wall that you don't like the Torah. Tell God, with all due respect to you, thank you for the oxygen, thank you for the water, thank you for the food, thank you for the millions you gave me, thank you for my brain, thank you for the wife and children, thank you for everything. Leave me alone. I'm not interested in any relationship with you. Don't give me this Torah. Okay, it's between you and him. I have no say here. I did not design the Torah. When God gave the Torah, he did not call me to consult with me. Mr. Mizrachi, what do you think? I should give this punishment, that punishment, this reward? Should I give a discount? Should I be more lenient? Should I be... Nobody asked me. If it was up to me, I would be a lot more lenient. But I'm one of you. Same way judge you will judge me. That's it. And I'm not speaking to you from I or you are law. It's just a matter of ignorance. I believe that none of you is evil person or bad person or on purpose wants to go against God. I believe, I give you the benefits of the doubt. But one thing I know from experience, that almost all the Jewish people I met in my life were 100% ignorant in Judaism. Because most of them never went to yeshiva. They never learned Torah. They went to public school in Israel, public school in America, public school in Europe. Over there you don't learn Torah, you don't learn Gemara, you don't learn Halakha, you don't know Rambam, you don't know Shulchan Aruch. In Israel you tell children Shulchan Aruch, they think it's a cookbook. They don't even know it's the name of the Jewish book of law. You ask, they made a survey, they asked people on the street, excuse me, do you know what Shulchan Aruch? Shulchan means a table, Aruch means set table. They were thinking probably something that talks about a table. Shulchan Aruch. Most of them say, I don't know. Some of them say, oh yeah, it's a cookbook. Not one secular Israeli kid or teenager knew what Shulchan Aruch is. Rav Ovadia Yosef Zatzal, the last few years of his life, one time he spoke with tears. He said, 1 million children in Israel. There were only 5 million Jews in Israel. Only 5 million. Now there's about 6. Back then it was 5. He said, 1 million children in Israel do not know how to say Shema Israel. The alphabet of every baby. In religious family, every baby 3 years old knows Shema Israel by heart. The mother reads it to him before he goes to sleep. Israeli teenager, nobody knows how to say Shema Israel. How can we not cry for such ignorance? Bezrat Hashem, it's never too late. Everyone that is smart and clever will wake up now. Get my book, get my films. There's a lot of material. Baruch Hashem, everything is free today. Everything. Lectures are free, YouTube free. You have my app, Divine Information 2.0. Download the app. You have thousands of lectures over there. In every topic, marriage, children, business, everything you can think of. As I don't think there's one topic we did not speak about. You have it all for free. Connected. Connected in the car, connected to the house. You can order my USB, 64 gigabytes. You connected to your screen, non-stop lectures, non-stop lectures. You understand? I know even people that because it's hard for them, because they're alone, they live alone in Shabbat, they don't have family, friends, whatever. So what do? They stick the USB, it plays all week. All week, non-stop lecture, they just keep it on. They're on Shabbat, they sit and watch lecture, because otherwise they will turn the TV on, or they're going to do other things in order for them not to be mechalel Shabbat. Say, no, at least I'm going to sit and watch lectures all Shabbat. They make themselves some food the entire Shabbat, besides sleeping and praying a little bit and eating. They watch lectures nonstop. Every Shabbat, 15 hours of lectures. They listen and listen and become very, very knowledgeable. There is a solution for every situation. I want to thank you very much. Thank you for organizing it. I hope that people will really take it serious, because it's not a joke what we talked here about. It's an opportunity of a lifetime to wake up. If you don't, next week you won't even remember this lecture. It's like they say in the Gemara, it's either now or chas v'shalom, never. Thank you very much. Have a wonderful Shabbat. If anyone has questions for me, I'm gladly will help, will be happy to answer.
Someone asked me, the rabbi, what do you think about the Tinokot Shenishbo?
Oh.
And there we have those guys in our generation.
Okay. Very good question. There is an expression in the Gemara of Jewish babies that were kidnapped by the Goyim when they were still babies. The Goyim used to come to Jewish neighborhoods and steal babies. And the babies, obviously, they grew up with the Goyim. They didn't know they are Jewish. So babies like this, that they grew up like Goyim, maybe they became Christian, maybe Muslim, maybe no religion, it's very difficult to punish them. They have no idea that they're Jewish. So this is obviously a Jew that is not a criminal. He just have no idea he's Jewish. However, somebody like that will still be judged, for instance, if he's a murderer. Because everybody knows you're not allowed to murder. You don't need to be Jewish to know it. Or if he's a thief. Everybody knows it's the wrong thing to do. Or if he doesn't believe in God, he's going to get punished. Because he's going to tell him, you saw this creation, you saw everything ready for you. Why didn't you look for me? Or if it's going to be a person that deceives people, or a violent person, or he's going to torture animals. So there are many, many things. Or if he doesn't respect his parents, nobody will punish him for eating chametz on Pesach. He doesn't even know what Pesach is. Nobody will punish him for not keeping Shabbat. He doesn't know what it is. No one will punish him for not putting tefillin or mezuzah. He has no idea what it is. So things that he had no way to know, there's no punishment. But things that he should have known, such as don't be a murderer, don't be a thief, don't be a rapist, don't make an abortion, believe in the belief that there is a God, things like this, he will still be punished for. Now there is something that is similar. Jews that were not kidnapped by Goyim, but their parents raised them like Goyim. They put them in public school. They grew up in Israeli kibbutz, or today in Tel Aviv, or in America, in all kinds of places that they had no idea about Judaism. Or in Russia, in Siberia, with the communist regime. Or even in Brazil, in some places that there's no Judaism. People like this are similar to Tinokot Shenishbu. But Rashi put the foundation. What does it mean, Tinok Shenishba? This is what Rashi said. Rashi said, if a person knows there is a God, and he knows there is a Jewish religion, he doesn't know exactly all the details, but he knows there is such a thing, a Jewish religion, and he knows there are religious Jews. He sees Hasidim, he sees people with black hats, people with yarmulke, he sees movies today in our days on YouTube, on television. He sees in Hollywood even they make movies about religious people. He knows his mother is Jewish. He knows he's Jewish. He sees religious people around in a country whenever he lives. And he does not come to check. Rashi says, not Tinok Shenishba. As a matter of fact, in our time, almost all the poskim, all the big rabbis ruled that the chilonim of today, the secular people, almost none of them is Tinokot Shenishbu. Besides people that really, really never knew that there's such a thing Shabbat. They never knew there's such a thing religious Jews. They had no idea. However, there is one shita, which is the Chazonish and the Lubavitch, Chabad, that for them almost everyone is Tinok Shenishba, the Chabad. But Chazonish, he said that some of the secular people are Tinokot Shenishbu, but Chazonish called all the Zionist communists wicked. Ben-Gurion, all the people in the Israeli government back in his time, he knew that they're all Reshaim. He did not hold that they are Tinokot Shenishbu. Ben-Gurion, he knew Tanakh, he knew Torah, he knew a lot of things, but he decided not to be Shomer Shabbat, to eat non-kosher. The Chazonish held that Ben-Gurion is a very big Rasha. And not only him, all the Israeli leaders of those days, the Chazonish held that they are all Reshaim. So who the Chazonish thought that they are Tinokot Shenishbu? The communists that came from out of nowhere, they had no idea about religion. Yes, some of them were Tinokot Shenishbu. I don't know the situation in Brazil, because I really don't know exactly how it works over there. But in all the countries that I've been and see communities, The Jews almost everywhere knows there is such a thing, synagogue, they know there is Shabbat, they know there is religious people, almost everybody know. Especially today with the internet, everywhere you go, you see rabbis, you see life after death, you see Jews against debate, a rabbi against the priest, all kinds of things, it's everywhere. So to say, I never knew there's such a thing, I don't know. If really, really he didn't know, he will still have a very big problem if he steals, if he speaks Lashon Hara about people, that's common sense. Or, you know, or if he's cruel to animals. There's a lot of things that secular people do, even if they don't know about religion, that they know that what they do is wrong. And it's not the right thing to do. It's not ethical. It's not moral. You know, they steal money from people. They forge signature. They take merchandise and don't pay. They do a lot of things that, for that, you don't need to be religious for that. You need to know that these things are forbidden. More questions? בעזרת השם.
היה כאן אצלנו בשיעור, כבוד הרב, כמה מהרבנים של הצוות שלנו, של הארגון שלנו עובדים כאן, קרוב רחוקים, כבוד הרב גם יכול גם לברך אותנו.
בעזרת השם. בעזרת השם, I give ברכה to every one of the listeners and all the רבנים that do קירוב. First of all, that every one of us, include myself, will all do תשובה every day. And בעזרת השם, that all the מקרבים will be very מצליח. I give you one tip from 25 years of experience that worked very, very well for me, Baruch Hashem, that don't be afraid of what people say, because the message goes into their heart and head. Doesn't matter. They can complain. They can say you're too strict. You spoke too hard. Don't be panicked. That means it hurts them. That means the truth hurts. The truth always hurts. If a person is smart, when someone tells him the truth in his face, it hurts him. Sometimes he reacts with pain, but it doesn't mean that it's something against you. He knows that you told him the truth. He knows you don't make it up. Don't be politicians. Don't sugarcoat the truth of the Torah. Prove that the Torah is divine. Learn to give them answer to every one of the questions. Baruch Hashem, the Torah has the answer to every question they ever ask the secular people, always. There's plenty of answers, and tell them always what's the good, the reward, and also what will happen to them if they choose to stay the way they are, not Shomer Shabbat. They have to know that. It's written when a person, before they execute a person in a bed din, if someone saw him, he has to give him atra'ah. He has to give him a warning, and he has to tell him where does it say in the Torah and what will be his punishment. If he did not tell him, the bed din cannot judge him. Because he's supposed to tell him, you should know that the Torah said that what you are doing is a very big sin, and that's the punishment for that. And he asked, where is it? He said, it has to be. It's right here in Parashat such and such. He has to tell him that. That's called the Atra. So it's our job. We don't have permission to modify the Torah, to show what we like or what we don't like, to hide. There is some speakers that that's what they do. They will speak 20 years. You will never hear one time in their speeches what's the punishments of the sins. Nothing. They decided to be the new Moshe Rabbeinu. They cut Sefer Dvarim, everything out. No moral, no ethic, no musar, no pun, nothing. They hide it. Even when they translate book, they skip parts of the books, Ramban, Adar Gdolim, Reshit Chochma. They translate to English. They cut parts out. When it speaks about Gehenom, when it speaks about serious punishment, they don't translate it. They decide to make a new Torah. That's not the way of Hashem. It's a very, very, very big sin and a very big crime to modify the Torah. They don't know that the Torah said that if you change my Torah, even by one letter, it's death penalty. They are religious people who do not present the Torah correctly. So I bless each one of you. Never to be afraid of people. Your job is to show them the Torah exactly as it's written. If Hashem wrote everything in the written Torah, that means every Jewish boy and girl must know it. Needless to say, adults. What Hashem didn't want everyone to know, he put in Kabbalah, secrets. But what's written in Chumash, everybody must know. You cannot tell them, no, no, if you ask your rabbi, is it true, Mechalel Shabbat is Mot Yumat? No, there's no such thing, God forbid. Hashem loves everyone, he's merciful. Be careful not to fall into these lies. You tell them, Baruch Hashem, yes, there are a lot of reward in the Torah, and there's also serious punishments. Bezrat Hashem, let's work with you, that you're starting to learn and become better and better, and you do tshuva, and none of this punishment will come to you. And even if you made millions of sins, you have to do tshuva, and all of them will go down the drain. There's not going to be any punishment if you do tshuva. This is the way to talk. People appreciate the truth. I'm telling you from experience. I can show you thousands of emails coming every month. Thousands. We love it because you show it as it is. We know that's the truth. I can count on everything you say. Why? Because I know you're not going to hide. I want you to tell me the truth. I made this sin. What exactly I have to do? This is how you build yourself. And this is how Hashem will help you to have results. To have publicity. To have a rating doesn't mean you make Baalei Tshuva. After a month, nobody remembers anyway the lectures. The people will only remember if after you spoke, it pinched their heart, it killed them. Wow, he's talking about me, I'm a Mechalel Shabbat. Oh, I'm eating pork, I'm eating chazir, I'm eating shrimps, I'm eating on Yom Kippur, I'm eating Chametz and Pesach, I live with a Goya, my children are not Jewish, according to what the Torah said. I'm in a very bad situation. Now he's going to wake up. If you tell him you're good, you're tzaddik, there's nothing to be afraid of, don't worry, how is he going to change? People never change until they know 100% that I'm going to have to pay big time for what I do. It's very difficult to change. If someone comes and says, no, you're good, Hashem loves everyone. What do you mean? I'm a murderer. No, Hashem loves you also. I eat chametz on Pesach. That's okay. Hashem loves everyone. That's not the truth. It's written in the Torah that Hashem loves the tzaddikim and hates the reshaim. The whole book of Reshit Chochmah talks about it. So we have to present the Torah exactly as it is. However, when you come to people that are totally beginners, of course you don't start right away with describe to them the punishment or Gehenom. No. First, you focus on a lot of proof. You tell them, look how I can prove to you in 2 hours the whole Torah is 100% divine. And then you teach them the purpose of life. And then you teach them a lot about the reward. You talk to them about Olam Haba, what does it mean, Olam HaNeshamot, what's going to happen. Every positive things to begin with. But then when you see that they're not making a progress, you have to slowly, slowly close the knot around their neck that they wake up. And sometimes you have to shake them up. And Bezrat Hashem, I give you mamash a blessing from my heart that you always will be strong not to be afraid to say the truth. And that you will see a fantastic result. You take people, you speak to them, and a month later you see how they're already religious. They keep mitzvot, they come to learn in yeshiva, in kolel at night, they get books, CDs, they begin to learn, they ask you questions. You see right away, within a month, a big change. If you work with the way I recommended to you, you won't believe how much success you're going to have. I know speakers, I know without saying names, that speak for 20 years. They give 2,000-3,000 lectures and they don't make one Baal Tshuva year. I know it for a fact. Now one Baal Tshuva year, because if you listen to the lecture, nothing over there is shaking. It's just parv. Nice, few jokes, stories, end of story. We don't want to work for nothing. We pray every morning in a tefillah, Shelo nira larik. Lo nira larik means that we don't put energy and efforts for nothing. Give us a blessing, Hashem, that all the energy we put will produce fruit. And the only way to produce fruit, the Torah says, not me, le'ahava u'le'ira et Hashem, to love and to fear God. Love alone, it's illusions. Fear alone, it's not good. It's not going to last. Love and fear will always work. That's the way it is. The same thing in chinuch. Yad yamin mekarevet, yad smol docha. Always like this. Good investigator, bad investigator. It has to be. This is the nature of a person. Bezrat Hashem, you all be successful. We will hear about thousands of new Baalei Tshuva every year in Brazil. Bezrat Hashem, thanks to all of you people. Hashem give you everything you need. פרנסה, בריאות, נחת מהילדים, that you should focus on the main mission to save as many souls as possible, בעזרת השם. Thank you very much for everyone. תודה רבה. Amen. Thank you very much. Shabbat shalom, everyone. כל טוב, כל טוב.